Jason, what have you been up to today?
Let's see. A buddy of mine came to town from Topeka, so I'm sure they were grateful to be out of that area for a little bit. He's one of my comic book buddies, so we got to talk about that. We went down to 1313 Mockingbird Lane, stole a bunch of stuff, which is why the police are pulling up right now. The positive experience all day long.
Now, when you say part of your comic book friends or part of your comic book days, is this when you were in fact part like when you were inside a comic book and have since like come out into the real world, or this is someone who you have also enjoyed comic books reading with, or someone you created comic books with?
Oh yeah, just that's one of the many things that we have in common is comic books. And he has a dearth of knowledge, and he does a bunch of stuff with action figures and stuff too. He
Oh, cool.
has an Instagram account, I think it's called Addicted to Plastic, where he takes action figures and creates pretty fantastic mock-ups and scenes and that sort of stuff. I come clean. My entire life and identity is based around a video game by the name of Comics Zone. I don't really want to draw attention to the fact that I am only 16 bits. I do a lot with loose clothing and just generally trying to look more 3D these days. But I am a 16-bit individual.
Being a comic book character, what advantages does that give you over someone more normal, say, Tim?
There are virtually no permanent consequences. I mean, at the end of the day, there's going to be a reboot. It's always safe to do whatever the heck you want to.
I've seen a
What?
lot of these kinds of stories. So if Tim or myself, if either one of us starts to find that we are appearing a little bit more and we're gradually becoming more important, that could be a warning sign that the writers are trying to get our characters warmed up to the audience, get us connected in such a way right before they cut us off. You know, I've often wished life were like a comic book, that I'd have gnarly powers and a comedic hook. I'd say goodbye to the humdrum and have a life that's exciting. I'd shoot stuff from my eyes and do a little bit of fist fighting. Imagine my surprise when I found a half-dead genie. He had a glint in his eye and looked just like Mr. Feeny. He said, "I'm real tired, but I will agree to grant you one wish." I said, "A comic book hero is what I want to be." Now I'm a duck, I'm a duck, I'm Howard the Duck. This wish sure went sideways, that's just my luck. No powers, just feathers. I'm a 3-foot-tall schmuck. I'm not a superhero, I'm Howard the Duck. I said, "What the hell? This is who you pick, a terrible character from a bad 80s flick. I have a big bill and flat feet and webbed toes. not how I wanted to get my ducks in a row. The genie frowned and was taken aback. He said, "No, my friend, it's perspective you lack. Allow me to explain before you give me flack." I looked him in the eye and said, "Quack, quack, 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 quack. I'm a duck, I'm a duck. I'm Howard the Duck. That wish sure went sideways, that's just my luck. No powers, just feathers, I'm a 3 foot tall schmuck. I'm not a superhero, I'm Howard the Duck." He said, "Howard is not a hero per se, but for you he's perfect in just the right way. He's trapped in a world that he never made. He smokes a cigar and sips margs in the shade. His stories are satires and existentialist. He will use his quack foo with his wingy fist. He comments on society with an outsider's eye. He's sardonic and raunchy, and that is why you're a duck. I'm a duck! Howard the Duck. I just get movie cameos, but I don't give a cluck. Pants are optional when you've got my pluck. I'm watching your world crumble. I'm Howard the Duck." Howard the Duck. I want eggs this morning. I have a craving for eggs.
Me too. You know, I've seen a village down there that has nothing but chickens and nothing but eggs. It's like an entire village made out of just chicken coops.
It's like a wonderland.
It truly is.
You know, I'm only sure of two things in this world. I love you, and I love eggs.
I love you too. Although I have to admit, my favorite food, I do kind of prefer just the taste of snake than I do to eggs, but.
I like snake. I wouldn't go far as to say that I love snake. Snake is a little bit too complicated and fussy of a protein. That's why I prefer the simplicity of eggs. You can do anything with an egg. It's like a magical food.
I would point out that snakes also have eggs.
They do, you know? I love snake eggs just as much as I love chicken eggs.
I, every once in a while, will do kind of a mix and match, and we'll make scrambled eggs out of both chicken and snake eggs.
They blend so well.
They really do.
You can't beat it. You've got the nice fluffy texture of the chicken egg, and then the sort of tougher leathery texture of the snake egg. Oh, it's a perfect marriage, just like you and me. You are the fluffy chicken, I'm the leathery snake. That didn't come out sounding so good for me.
Join the crew of the Trilobite as they struggle to keep rich douchebags happy on the open seas in All Aboard.
My name is Gwyneth McKillicuddy, and I'm used to having everybody wait on me hand and foot because I don't like to lift the finger unless it's to point to someone and tell them what to do.
Bertram Wiglet Slide here. I'm looking forward to a luxury experience in the North Sea with my beloved. Luxury.
Welcome aboard. My name is Captain Dave. This is my retirement gig after I retired as an airline captain.
I'm Bethany. I'm here to make everything for the guests comfortable as well as provide additional services. And you don't have to yell. I'm trying my best, okay?
Hey, dudes. Chef Elliot Grimes here. I totally dig cooking things, and I totally dig cooking things on a super expensive yacht. Dude.
Captain, I've been meaning to have a word with you. You see,
I'm a very wealthy person because of who I married and who her father is and how much money he has. And as such, I'm used to the best. And I want to know that you're the best.
You got nothing to worry about here, Wiggle Smythe. I know who you are and I know exactly what could happen to me if I don't make you happy. So welcome to the USS Trilobite. Tell me what you need and I will make sure that someone gets it for you.
Yes, you see, both my wife and I suffer from night terrors. So it's very important that nothing happens at night that we are disturbed ever. We must never be disturbed in the night time.
I can already anticipate a few challenges. We will be going through Screaming Bay right around 11 o'clock into about 5 o'clock in the morning. We'll be more than happy to set you up with some complimentary earplugs. You just shove a couple of those in each ear and I think you'll sleep sound as a manatee baby.
I'm sorry, I don't know if you recognize exactly how rich we are. We do not shove things anywhere. Even the word coming out of my mouth, shove, it's such a lower class word. Are you a lower class captain, Captain Dave?
Oh, I am full class, I tell you. Now, where that falls in the actual class, I am top of my class. I'll be honest, I've had a little more to drink than I usually do when we
As have I, Captain Dave, as have I.
We are going to get along a-okay, Berthel.
I'm going to retire to my cabin for exactly 45 minutes. When I wake up, I shall be more ravenously hungry than I've been in my entire life. And I would like all of this service to be made of rose quartz.
I guarantee you that you will have roses and quartz of them by the time you wake up.
Hello, welcome to the USS Trilobite. I know it's a real little small yacht, but I'm here to solve all of your needs. Let me just get your bags for a second. Oh God, I'm sorry. I've already lost a couple over the edge.
Oh, you are going to send me over the edge.
I hope that's okay. I really can't get fired again.
Thanks for joining me here, Bethany. I got a vital mission for you here. The rich couple. I need you to put some earplugs in their ears. They're being weird about it.
I forgot to order some more earplugs from our last trip. I'm sorry about that, Captain Dave. I know it's number one on the priority list, but
Bethany, it is not just number one on the it's the only thing on the list.
You're right. It only says earplugs. I thought I would take some initiative and order more food instead.
Well, did you order any small food, finger foods, those little cocktail weenies, shrimp, anything that will fit into an ear canal?
Well, I did order some shrimp, but I thought we were going to catch more of those on the way. I could use one of the candles in my room and just kind of whittle it down. That it's either that or make earplugs for my own earwax. And I know the last time I did that, we got sued really hardcore. So I try to avoid that one.
Oh, dude, I usually don't have guests down here in my galley.
Well, I'm not just any guest. I am VIP plus.
Oh, I could tell that the minute I looked at you. Very important
person.
Are you saying you want me to cook person for dinner?
Fresh. I like it that way. Fresh. Yes.
Whatever you want. Chef Elliot is here. I'm here to add a personal touch to your meal. I'll do whatever it takes. I'm a chef on a yacht. I want to make sure that what happened between you and I last week will not affect our jobs personally or professionally.
Oh, no, no, it won't affect us in any way, but I did sneak off one of the, I locked off one of the side rooms for later if, you know, you want to do something.
I might. Who knows what I want from one moment to the next? Not me.
That's what makes you so exciting. You're just so spontaneous.
I'm unpredictable. You know what? You're the best. You're just like my bro.
Oh, that is not quite what I was hoping for.
You should not speak to me unless you are spoken to.
She's a McGillicuddy of the New Hampton McGillicuddies.
I am fully aware of who chartered my GD boat, all right? I will meet every single one of your demands, but I'm gonna have to ask you to talk a little quieter, please.
Your crew offered earplugs to my husband, and you want me to talk quieter. Why don't you just take those earplugs and stuff them into your own ears?
Oh, there's that word again, that stuff word. It makes me feel so uncomfortable.
I apologize. Just let me, there we go. Oh, yeah, it's one of the cocktail weenies.
How dare you use the word weenie in front of my wife?
Oh, my apologies. You are correct. You are the guest. It is a cocktail wiener.
Oh, God, I'm so sorry. I thought I knocked over the shrimp bowl.
That's okay. I knocked over that shrimp bowl 4 times before you came in. You just scoop them back up, put them on the plate, wash them off, cook them again.
So we've got everything under control.
Oh, night terrors! Night terrors!
God. Elliot, I need you to whip up the finest plate of frog legs that you can muster.
All right. I'll have to throw away my plate of wieners.
No, no, no. Don't throw it.
Clara and Eugene, welcome. The final episode of Sir Mimer.
Woo. Feels pretty good.
Now, it's not surprising that it's the two of you here in the final. I went back and I looked, and out of the 9 challenges, Clara, you came in first place 4 times and 2nd place 2 times. And Eugene, out of the 9 challenges, you came in first or 2nd place 8 times. We truly have the cream of the crop right here in front of us. The two of you are facing off. It's just you left.
Oh, thanks for sticking with us, everybody.
I think my performance has been about as smooth and creamy as it gets.
In our very special final episode, we will revisit some of our past challenges to find out which one of you head-to-head is the true Sir Mimer champion.
Oh, all right. I try not to do anything in my life twice, but I'll make an exception for you.
So I have 7 mini challenges for you today. Clara, I see you are not in a place that you normally are.
No, I am somewhere else.
Hold on just a second.
Okay.
I thought I recognized these blinds.
Oh, yeah. I forgot to tell you I was coming over.
Oh, all right. Wait, it's really nice being vaccinated.
Yeah, I know. It's great.
I don't
Eugene,
do you
feel like you're at a disadvantage since you're not, like, actually here?
I'm smelling some dirty pool. I think there might be some insider trading going on that I don't like the smell of. I mean.
Okay. I'm going to report back to my station.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'll see you both later.
Okay. Eugene, you're just gonna be a crank tonight, huh?
I've been trying to get to point in my life where I would be okay, you know, being a failure. But that's just not who I just, you know, I really try to put myself in the headspace of people who just are losers. Just because, like, you know, it could, I'm not saying like I'm infallible.
I don't have a big mean speech to do at you, so.
I don't mean to.
No, I'm good.
I don't mean to be mean, kiddo. You know,
you're. Whoa.
What's the matter? I don't see no gray hair.
I'm gonna fight you. I'm gonna fight you so hard right in the face. Let's get this going, John.
There's a spirit. I see no spirit like that until now, but I appreciate that.
Mini challenge number one. You remember back at the very beginning, we did a scavenger hunt. This is the scavenger hunt portion of your challenge. What I would like for you to do right now, find a piece of fruit. Go.
John, I'm in your house. Oh my God. Do you have fruit, John? Where's your fruit?
Done.
All right. Some vegetables. Okay, there we go. Josh has completed this challenge first. There you go. You both found bananas.
Two brown bananas. That's eerily uncomfortable.
Three.
In that case, Clara was at a minor disadvantage because she did not know specifically where the fruit was, although my place is very small, so it did not take her long.
Yeah.
All right. Eugene, you win that round.
Well, crap.
The second challenge you both did was the high temperature challenge.
Yeah. And
Clara had a little bit of a hard time with that one, but Eugene won for his team. If you recall, we wrapped it up by predicting the high temperature of the rover landing site on Mars.
Room temperature.
Yep. Okay. I'm back.
72 degrees.
Predict what was the high temperature today in Fahrenheit for Sicily in Italy.
Ready.
Okay, both of you reveal your answers.
76?
66. Correct answer. High temperature today, 85.
I was closer.
Clara, you win that round.
Nice.
Your week three challenge was the coin challenge. So what I need both of you to do right now is find a quarter. Okay. Can both of you please look and tell me what year is that quarter?
2006.
2004.
The point for this round goes to the person with the oldest quarter.
Oh.
So that one goes to Eugene.
Oh, wait, hold on a second. I'm sorry. I misread it. It says 1974.
I don't like that.
I was holding it wrong.
Yeah, that's right.
It was in front of the one I meant to pick.
Oh, there you go. Wrong.
The week five challenge involved you drawing a grid and coloring in squares.
Yep.
What I'd like for you to do right now, draw a 5x5 grid and get as close as you can to that original grid, even though you have not seen it for 5 weeks.
Oh,
wow. Oof, I don't feel good about this.
How many people are in my house?
Oh, I invited some friends over.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
For the record, that I was not one of those friends. I want the record to show that, please.
Duly noted.
Thank you. I want to make sure that it's clear that I did not come here to make friends. Is that clear?
I did.
Okay.
I failed tremendously at that. Oh. But
although, Eugene, I think you also failed because I am your friend.
Ah. Well, I guess I failed at something.
Okay, hold up your grids. Okay, so Here is the original grid. Clara gets 14 points.
Okay.
That good?
Eugene gets 15 points.
Oh, okay.
That was
difficult. Oh, I had it upside down.
Difficult to remember 5 weeks in the future.
Yeah.
A little bit.
Week 8 was the haiku challenge. We are not writing another haiku.
Okay.
Instead, we are writing a two-sentence rhyming couplet. Two sentences make it about Sir Mimer in some way and make it rhyme. All right, Eugene, let's hear what you've got.
I wanted no friend. John got me in the end.
Very nice. I love it. And Clara, let's hear what you've got.
In many ways, these games were fun, but now I'm feeling very dumb. Slant rhyme.
Good, good. At this point, because I cannot appear to be playing favorites, I cannot reward Eugene's use of me in his couplet with a win. I have to give that one to Clara.
I can't help that you fooled me into befriending you.
And it came back to bite you.
Yeah, for viciously in the tuchus.
Last week's challenge, week 9, was the shoelace challenge. Can you please each grab a pair of shoes? Those are actually the same shoes, aren't they?
It's the same shoes.
Do they have to have laces?
That is not a requirement today. Beginning with how the shoes are right now, the first person to get both shoes on their feet will win this challenge. Starting now. Clara's shoes are on.
They're slip ones.
They are technically on your feet.
These are you juniors' size 3 shoes. So, to be fair,
got it.
You did not say they needed to be my shoes.
Week 7 was the strategy challenge where you assign splats to each other. Eugene, you get six splats to assign to one of you. Clara, you get 5 splats. You'll write down who are you assigning splats to. You can split them however you want. At the end of this round, if you have an odd number of splats, you win the round. So what do you think the other person is going to do? Eugene has 6 to assign, and Clara has 5.
Okay.
Okay, let's start with Clara. Where do those 5 splats go? 3 to Clara, 2 to Eugene. All right, Eugene, where are your splats going?
Well, they went here.
1 to Clara, 5 to Eugene. Eugene has 7. That is the odd number. Eugene, you take this round.
Hang it.
Eugene, you won 4 rounds. That means, Eugene, you have won Sir Mimer. He's so shocked he's gone. There he is.
I sent electricity through my telephone and it shorted out for a moment. Well, first of all, I am a good sport, despite all of the words otherwise. And I would like to say a good game, Miss Clara. You have fought valiantly through these ever long weeks, and I respect your gameswomanship.
Well, thank you very much.
Oh, you're more than
I would like to say a hearty congratulations to me for making it this far, and to you for making it farther than I did. So, congratulations to both of us, and to John for going the distance as well. You really kept up.
You know, I agree. I you know, like I said, I didn't plan on making friends, and if I had it my way, I wouldn't have. But you know, if I won anything, it was a heck of a good friendship, and I'll bring that to my grave, and likely I'll bring you to my grave as well.
Yay.
On behalf of myself, as well as the 10 other contestants, congratulations, both Eugene and Clara. You did great. And all 12 of you were winners in my book. That's it for Sir Mimer. Thank you all for watching. I can't wait to see what happens in season 2. Until then, Seacrest out. Perhaps you'd like to examine my tongue.
Ha!
I added in the shimmy for free.
I'm Howard the...
Whoa.
Does this do anything for you?
Strangely enough, it does. Come inside.